how has it been for you seeing people dying of COVID?
You know, mum's really sick, she may not survive. And then half an hour later, they phone back and they actually, your dad's now really sick as well and he may not survive. I think that's been...
It makes you question whether you're doing the best you can for people under the circumstances.
My dad died during the pandemic. So I had, so I'm one of those people that's had that experience, which has been hard.
Has the pandemic made you think more about death and dying?
Yeah, I think it has actually, Rick. I think that's partly what I was struggling with a bit mentally when we were going through the pandemic. It sounds utterly ridiculous, but I'm still not over the death of my cat. And I lost my cat 12 years ago. And I still...
Hi, I'm Patricia Charlesworth and I'm from the palliative care for people with learning disabilities network. Welcome to our webinar today and hope you enjoy it and you may learn something from it.
First of all, we asked how COVID-19 has affected people in their job. Pat talks with Claire Towns, CEO and matron at the Mary Stevens Hospice.
Thank you very much for your time, you know. It's very, very kind of you to give up this time for it so that I can interview you.
You're very welcome.
Thank you. Okay, so the first question is, what has your life been like since lockdown and what changes has there been?
Do you mean at work, Pat?
Yes.
Yeah, we've had to do things a lot differently. We haven't had as many visitors, so we've had times where we've had to really restrict the visitors into the building. And we're used to sort of saying, you know, everyone's friends and family can come and visit all day long.
Yeah. You know, because I visited my father in St. Joseph's Hospice here in Hackney.
Yeah.
And they're all very, very nice people. And they're very, very inviting. It must be quite hard for you. How's that made, you know, how has that affected you as a person? As a human being?
I think it makes you question whether you're doing the best you can for people under the circumstances. And as a human, it's hard not to be able to reach out and touch people, whether it's colleagues, to maybe support them as much. Mm. And you're watching them going through hard times. It's quite a hard job at times. And we rely, don't we, on our family and friends and being able to have them in and just to have a chat and to talk about what's going on. And I think we've all had the same experience, haven't we, where perhaps we haven't had those different people that we've been allowed to mix with, to chat. So that's probably the hardest thing.
Thank you.
Sam and Peter talk with Dr. Hilary Ted, consultant in respiratory medicine. That's a lung doctor at Newcastle-upon-Tyne Hospitals.
Hello, Hilary. How has it been for you seeing people dying of COVID?
I think the thing that we found really difficult, I found personally very difficult, is there's a lot more people dying than I would normally see, and that's very difficult. And because it's a disease that will hit a household, you'll often have, you know, people who are all in the hospital and well at the same time. So you might have, you know, dad, mum, and, you know, a child, not a child, but, you know, a middle-aged child, for example, and their parents will all be in hospital with the COVID, and then one of them may die, and you're still having to look after one of the other ones whilst they're also grieving, and that's been really difficult. And we have had some really sad situations where we've had families coming in and both dying. So, you know, granny and granddad coming in, and then one dying, and then next one dying very soon afterwards. And that's definitely felt very different to what we normally see. That's something that is not normal for us to have to kind of speak to a family and say, you know, your mum's really sick, she may not survive. And then half an hour later, then phone back and say, actually, your dad's now really sick as well, and he may not survive. I think that's been probably one of the biggest challenges that we've all faced ourselves emotionally, is how you manage that situation.
What is the, is there any part of the work that you find challenging?
So sometimes you've got patients who you don't know what's quite wrong with them, you haven't worked it out yet. That's quite difficult because you're desperately trying to work out what the best thing to do for the patient is when you're not quite sure what the problem is. That's difficult. And also sometimes explaining to families that we don't know something is difficult. So I think people often think as doctors that we know loads and that we know what's going to happen. And in a lot of cases we don't. So coronavirus is a really good example of that, that there were patients who were really poorly and the families would say to us, do you think that they're going to live? And I just didn't know the answer to that. And it's very difficult to explain to a family that you don't really know what's going to happen. You don't know what's going to happen to them today or tomorrow or a week's time. And that's very difficult for families to understand. And that's very difficult for us to explain sometimes, that what we would call like that uncertainty is quite difficult to explain.
Richard talks with Nikki Fox, disability correspondent, BBC News.
Hello, Nikki. Thank you for agreeing to answer some questions for our group Grassroots. Thank you.
My absolute pleasure, Richard. Absolute pleasure.
And it's nice to see you again. It is.
What has it been like to be a news reporter during the pandemic?
You probably don't know this about me. Not many people do. I tend to keep it private. But although I absolutely do everything I can to avoid crying in public, I am quite emotional. I'm quite a sensitive person. So a lot of the stories that we were covering, it was endlessly upsetting. And it's not my place to get upset about these stories because it's nothing to do with me and I'm not living it. But I think emotionally, I found it quite tough.
That brings me to my next question. Is that so? I was going to ask, that does the BBC have a place where you can go and you're like, maybe talk to somebody or have a chill out place where you can just... You know, if someone's been quite distressing or upsetting, if you've got somewhere like where you can just go and talk to somebody, have the BBC got that, have they?
That's a good question. They do, Richard. We were getting emails, every single week from senior management saying, you know, we understand that this is a difficult situation. And obviously we were dealing with a topic that impacted people's lives, you know. And so they were always sending around emails. Just saying, if you need to speak to somebody, call this person. They were running in kind of drop-in sessions that you could dip in and out of if you wanted to online. There's so much help if you need it. I honestly, I've never used it, but I know it's there and I know people have.
You also sound like you've got a nice bubble what you're in, so with your family, so that's good. That is
very lucky.
Yes.
Pat talks with Claire Henry, MBE, who has had national leadership roles in palliative and end of life care, who went back to the front line during COVID. What has been hard?
Breaking bad news over the phone, because some people chose not to come in if people were dying for all sorts of reasons. For me, on a personal level, it made me think what's important to me and those little things, you know, family, friends, not all the big things are really important. But it's just made me realise that you need to make sure you say the things that are important, that you love people, that you have that time and those conversations and, you know, going out for a coffee or just very simple things really are those important things. So that's how it's reflected on me and the amazing of coming together with the staff and how kind people could be to each other.
We wanted to know about people's personal experience with death and dying during COVID. Pat and Peter listened to Claire Henry.
But I've also, very sadly, my dad died during the pandemic. So I'm one of those people that's had that experience. which has been hard, but there's also been some really the local support was amazing. We had the village came out when it was my dad's funeral, so everybody lined the streets, which was absolutely incredible.
You just spoke about your father dying. I'm really sorry about that. You know, it must have been very, very hard for you. Did you manage, you spoke a little bit about the funeral and the people standing outside. So you actually had a funeral?
Yes, we did. We were only able to have 20 people at the service. So hence why it was just amazing that so many people came out in the village. There was all lined, and when we got the bell rung for at the church, and there was lots of people stood at the church, and my dad would have absolutely loved that. It was amazing. We felt very supported by the local village.
Mm, that's really, really good that you had that. And because other people, I've heard that they weren't allowed to have a funeral. They had to have a funeral on Zoom, and how disturbing that was.
We had, because we could only have 20 people there, we had a lot of people joining us via Zoom as well, because we actually were able to have the funeral sort of live streamed from the crematorium. So that was a different experience. It was comforting for us as a family to know people were there, but it was very sad that we couldn't have people there, because it was, you know, you did feel very isolated, because people couldn't obviously hug you, and it was quite difficult in that sense. So yes, I think a lot of people have had that experience like we did.
Peter reflected on what Claire told them.
Because you spoke about the people that are close to you, if we all give confidence, for those who are not confident of speaking, it will give confidence for those who speak up close to them. But what if deaf and dying is not in your usual day's work? Richard and Vince asked Nicky Fox.
Has the pandemic made you think more about deaf and dying?
Yeah, I think it has actually, Rich. If I'm being honest, I've always thought the one thing in life that I will not be able to cope with is the bereavement of a loved one. I've spoken about this only once to a very close friend of mine who lost her husband. I can't even think about, you know, I worry constantly about my mum and dad and my sister and the people that I love. And I'll be honest with you, I mean, none of us can cope with it. I probably learn a lot from your group, actually, because I think that's going to be a real shocker for me, actually. I mean, even, I know it sounds utterly ridiculous, but I'm still not over the death of my cat, and I lost my cat 12 years ago, and I still can't think about, well, I just, you know, I really struggle, you can probably tell. It's a really good question, because I think that's partly what I was struggling with a bit mentally when we were going through the pandemic. I mean, I didn't let it show. Obviously, in my job particularly, it's not something I could switch off from. So we were always talking and speaking to the loved ones of people who had died. So that made me kind of think about it more. And yeah, I did find that hard. So it's a very good question, Richard. Because I did. And I do think that that is partly why. Yeah, it's just awful, you know.
It is. And pets, I understand what you say about pets, because they are like part of the family. They are the family, aren't they? You know, they're always there to say hello to you and all that. Anyway, thank you for answering my questions. Now I'm going to hand you over to my colleague, Vincent.
Well, thank you, Richard, because they were brilliant questions.
Good afternoon, Nikki.
Hey, Vince, how are you?
Oh, not too bad, thank you. Lovely to see you again.
Lovely to see you.
So I've got a few questions for you as well.
Go on, Vince, go on.
It's pretty much about your mental health, really, because this has been a big subject, hasn't it, in the news lately, with mental health and obviously during the pandemic and that. So how has your mental health been? What have you done to keep your mental health stable, if you know what I mean? You know?
Yeah, it's a good question. I think I am naturally have a sunny disposition. I do have my moments, and throughout the pandemic, they have been a bit more frequent because of the nature of my job and the stories that we've been covering. I've been a bit stressed about work lately. Everything's got on top of me and I don't really talk about it. And so I always believe in the one thing that we can all do for ourselves in life is do whatever we can to make ourselves feel like the bee's knees. I really work hard at preparing before I do a news story or a live. I can't always do that in news because, as you guys very well know, because you've worked with us before, everything's so fast. Oh, guys, we've got to go. So in some ways, working in news and being that type of person and a perfectionist doesn't always work. But, I like to gen up and I like to be as good as I can be for everything I do. And that basically in turn makes me feel good about myself. And I think if you feel good about yourself, then you can handle most things in life.
Thanks, Nika. Yeah, that was lovely to hear that. Thank you.
Next question. How about people with disabilities?
And what about people with lung disabilities? Do you see any improvement in that area?
I have heard some really good stories, but I still think there's an awful long way to go to make sure people do get the support.
We need to support different groups in society who've got different needs to ensure that they can access the care in the same way, so that there's it's equitable.
So what's it been like seeing patients with learning disabilities?
My real worry was about things like when we said we weren't going to have visitors in the hospital. We spoke quite quickly about this problem and we all agreed that if you had a learning disability, you would be allowed to have visitors in, even if you had coronavirus. One amazing mum I remember, whose son was poorly, who's in his early 20s and has got a learning disability and has lots of other health problems. And she just stayed in the hospital with him for the whole time. So she just, when it was lunch, we took two lunches to them. When it was tea, they got two teas. We made sure that she had everything that she needed and they just stayed together in a cubicle. We put a bed in there for her. And so it was fine.
They're no different from anybody else. They have the same things as everybody else has. Yeah. It's just that they have a learning disability and they need a little bit of extra support, maybe. You know, it's really, absolutely, really important. So
it is. It needs voices like yours to be heard.
I think that you should be really proud of everything that you've done this year, because you've managed to help teach the rest of us what we should be doing. So, thank you very much.
Yeah, it's what you call well reversed, isn't it?
Yeah, but we can all learn from each other, can't we? That's the important thing, isn't it?
Yes, it's more like it's a two-way street, isn't it? We all talk together about what it is like to be disabled.
I was dyslexic. I am dyslexic. And at school, I really, really academically struggled hugely.
My head teacher at my first school, he said to my mum and dad that I couldn't be taught and fed to me. So I understand, because I've got dyslexic like you. I am dyslexic as well as my learning difficulty. Yes.
Do you know what? It angers me so much, doesn't it? As well, because I've had personal experiences, as have you, Richard. I had some great teachers, but I also had some ones that kind of did the same thing to me and just made me feel utterly useless, just like I was never going to be able to do anything. I just, hearing that with you as well, that makes me really sad, and I'm sorry that that happened to you, and I hope that doesn't happen anymore. I really do.
Yeah, but all my mum and dad's friends are so proud that I've been on the BBC News. They are, for when you interviewed me on there. Yes.
Look at you now, though. Look at all the great work that you guys are all doing together. Yes. Look at it. I mean, unbelievable.
It is really important to talk about death and dying. Thank you to all our interviewees for being so open with us. Let's all keep talking.
We enjoyed that. We'd love to do more interviews. How did we do?
I never say anything I don't mean, okay? They were some of the best questions. I get interviewed an awful lot for various magazines, for, you know, all sorts. And honestly, I thoroughly, thoroughly enjoyed that chat. And they were some of the best questions I've ever been asked in an interview.
Any top tips from a professional interviewer?
You don't need them. Honestly, what you did was brilliant. You just asked really pointing questions that weren't ridiculous in a really beautiful way. I interview people all the time, and it's very difficult to get people to really be open and honest and feel comfortable. And you guys did that within a split second. And that is an interview skill that you actually can't learn. And you guys did so well, because I don't often, people always tell me off, they're like, we never really know the true you, like, you never really give much away. But my God, went straight down with you guys.
But we always end our webinars with a music theme we do. This song is from Lars Canada, and Lars is an international organisation which also supports me here in London, the UK.
Grab your dance partner, get sassy, get this, go red line, and da, 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 da. And let's get started. How you doing?
Tout va merveilleusement bien. Et toi, Nick?
Busy.
On est fiers de vous présenter.
And now, the moment you've been waiting for. Here with the song, Grease Lightning.
Why, this car is automatic. It's systematic. It's hydromatic. Why, it's Grease Lightning.
Grease Lightning. Get some overhead lifters and four valve pods, oh yeah. Injection cut up in chrome plated rods, oh yeah.
I'll get the money, I'll get the money.
With new pistols, clubs, and shots, I can get all my rocks. You know that I ain't bragging, she's a real pussy wagon. Grease Lightning.
You want to wear my old leather jacket. I have a brown leather jacket. We're fighting for our rights. Standing for our rights. And that's the whole idea. For people with disabilities, because we rock disability. And don't let your disability stop you from reaching your dreams. And but keep reaching for the stars anyways.
We hope you've enjoyed watching this webinar.
I hope you found it useful.
I hope to see you again next time.
Don't forget to like and subscribe.